already started with erosion, or in fact initiation of motion, and I will show you a little bit more about that topic. And at the end I will show you some equations how to apply it for hopper dredges or rivers or whatever. I told you yesterday that in 1936 Mr. Shields started research in Germany. He was an American, but he did the research in Germany. And based on that, we have the so-called Shields curve. So everybody in literature also calls it the Shields curve. It took up to about 87 before there were some people who tried to make a mathematical model to put it in equations. So there were fit equations, we call it empirical equations, but there was not really a good theory. But Weiberg and Smith, Weiberg is a female and Smith is a male, they did research and tried to create a mathematical model. And what did they do? Well, they said, if we assume that sand consists of spheres, so here you have a number of spheres under a certain slope, and one of the spheres is a little bit above the rest, that means that sphere will catch the flow. The flow will exert a force on that sphere. Then the sphere will start moving if the force on the sphere is big enough. Well, you can imagine, if you consider real sand, that this is a simplification. It's very simple, but it's a start. If you look at the sphere, you have a number of forces on the sphere. Later you will get some better picture, but this is a copy from the literature. So we have an FD, which is the drag force, so the force based on the flow. You have a lift force, you have gravity, and you have a resisting force. The resisting force, in fact, is gravity times a friction coefficient. So it's not two separate forces, but you need the gravity force in order to be able to determine the resisting force from the friction. They found an equation like this. You don't have to remember the equation. I'm just showing what they found. And here you have the tau star, which is the shield parameter. Very often they use the theta for that parameter. And in the equation you see some angles. Beta is the slope angle, phi is the internal friction angle, so in fact that's the friction coefficient. The tangent of phi is the friction coefficient. And here you see the ratio between lift force and drag force. They also assumed a certain velocity profile above the bed. So this is the velocity, this is the distance above the bed, and then you get a certain velocity profile. But since this is logarithmic coordinates, this is linear, but this is logarithmic, in linear coordinates the first part would be a straight line, so that's the viscous sublayer where you have a linear velocity distribution. This is the logarithmic distribution, but if you put a logarithmic function on logarithmic coordinates, it becomes a straight line. Yeah, so that's why now this is a straight line and this is a curved line. In this picture you can see the result of their equation, which is this line, but in gray you can see the measurements of Mr. Shields, and you can see it gets close, but not entirely. They did some mathematical tricks to make it fit better, and with those tricks you get the middle curve, which matches Shields pretty well. In fact, what did they do? They said, okay, if you have a viscous sublayer on one hand, and above the viscous sublayer you have turbulence. Turbulence consists of a lot of eddies, vortices, eddies. And if such an eddy, so a rotating piece of fluid, hits the viscous sublayer, the viscous sublayer gets smaller, thinner. And at that, but since the amount of water flowing through that viscous sublayer remains the same, the velocity will increase, and because of that, you have higher forces on the particles. And basically what you can see here is the top line is if you use the full thickness of the viscous sublayer, this is 0.6 and this should be 0.3. In their graph it says 3, but it is 0.3. So if you reduce the thickness of the viscous sublayer, you can create higher forces, and that's how they get the curves. Yeah. Now we will look at the physics in more detail, and I will do it step by step so you can see the influence of each part of the physics on the process. First of all, this shows the velocity distribution, but now horizontally you have the distance to the wall and vertically you have the velocity, so basically it's the same graph that you saw from Weiberg and Schmidt, but rotated 90 degrees. So this part is the viscous sublayer, this part is the logarithmic profile, and in between you have a transition area. Those graphs are not too important, but this graph is. You already saw that in the Weiberg and Schmidt approach you need a friction coefficient. How big is that friction coefficient? Because we are not talking about dense sand. You are talking about the sand particles that are at the surface of the bed. So they are not really compacted, so probably the friction there is a little bit lower than inside a bed. Well, some people did measurements for this friction angle as a function of the particle size, and what you see is for very small particles, so this is 1 millimeter, 10 to the zero, you get a friction angle of about 30 degrees, a little bit less, a little bit below 30 degrees, and the bigger the particle, the higher the friction angle. Yeah, that's the result of their research. The explanation of this is that small particles are usually rounded by the river, and if you have more round particles, the friction angle is smaller. While bigger particles, like gravel and boulders, usually they are not that rounded, so they are more angular, and the result is a higher friction angle. Yeah. So, but in general, we will use a friction angle of about 30 degrees in all the examples, because most particles will be in this range. Yeah, here you have 10 to the 1, that's 10 millimeters. Well, 10 millimeters is already gravel. That's not normal sand anymore. Which forces do we have? We start with a simple approach, and you have two possibilities in this approach. You can say, okay, I take a particle and we consider it to be a sphere, and we assume it will start sliding. Well, what do we have? Somewhere we have the drag force because of the velocity of the fluid. We have the gravity force, so that's the weight of the particle, but the submerged weight because it's always underwater. And then you multiply it with the friction coefficient and you get your resisting force. So in this simple approach, we only assume the drag force and the friction force. All the other forces we forget. The second possibility is that the particle will start rolling, and when it starts rolling, still you have the drag force and the weight, but the resisting force is not important, because if it doesn't start sliding, you don't have friction. Yeah, but we have the weight. So you can, around the point where this sphere touches the sphere below, you can make an equilibrium of moments. You have the drag force that wants to make it rotate, and you have the weight, the gravity force, that wants to keep it in place. So that also gives you an equation. If you look, you don't have to remember those equations now, because I already put everything on blackboard. But here you see theta, which is the Shields parameter, which is that dimensionless shear stress. And the equation for the Shields parameter is in fact very simple. It's the u star squared, so that was the friction velocity squared, divided by the relative submerged density for sand 1.65, g, and the particle diameter. And then you find an equation for this Shields parameter, for the critical Shields parameter, I should say, because what we are calculating here is the moment it starts moving. Yeah, that's why we call it the initiation of motion. Here you see the equation for rolling, which is a little bit more complicated, because to determine those moments you also need the arms. So this is an arm here, this is an arm. You need those arms to determine your moments. What does it... the drag coefficient we already discussed. So this is the drag coefficient with all the measurements in the graph. This was the drag coefficient for materials which are not spherical, so also different shapes, but we already saw this yesterday. And this is for natural sands. They also did some separate measurements. And then what does it look like? Well, basically we have two cases. You have the case of particles that are 100% inside the viscous sublayer. That means the flow is laminar around the particles. And you have the case of particles that are 100% in the turbulent region. So they suppose the thickness of your viscous sublayer is 1 millimeter, and you consider a particle of 10 centimeter, then you can say it's 100% in the turbulent region. Well, laminar means small Reynolds numbers. So again, here we have that Reynolds number, and here we have the Shields parameter, and normally for that Reynolds number we take the particle diameter times the friction velocity divided by the viscosity. Yeah, so that's the Reynolds number. So this area is small particles which are in the viscous sublayer. Large Reynolds numbers means big particles, so we are in the turbulent region. And in this graph, I didn't make a connection between the two. Normally they say at 11.6 Reynolds you have the transition from laminar to turbulent. Yeah, so below 11.6 everything is laminar, above 11.6 everything is turbulent. The blue line is rolling and the green line is sliding. And in both cases I assume that 50% of the particle is above the bed, so 50% of the particle is subject to flow. Yeah, and the other 50% is covered by the bed, so I don't have flow there. We will talk about that in more detail later. So what do you see? You see curves that do not really match the measurements. Not good enough, although they are not that far from the measurements, but it could be better. And the other thing you see is that for this specific case, rolling has the blue line which is higher than the green line. So apparently it's easier to start sliding in this situation, so with that 50% above the bed, it's easier to start sliding than to start rolling. Yeah, so if you would do this, particles will start sliding and not start rolling. So this is not yet good enough, but we only consider the drag force on the particles and we consider the gravity. So maybe there are other forces. What is the other force we have? Lift. Because a particle that is subject to flow will also have a certain lift. And lift is rather complicated, because you don't really have a good theory for that, but you have equations for it. And in fact, for the lift, we use the same equation as for the drag, but then with the lift coefficient. And if you have the correct lift coefficient, okay, you should be able to give a good prediction. So the equation becomes a little bit more complicated, because here we have the lift force. For the rest, everything is the same, because we still have the drag force and the gravity force. In the case of sliding, we have to deduce the lift force from the gravity force, because lift is always upwards and gravity downwards, so the normal force of the particle to the particles below it is less, because I have lift. Yeah, so that's why we deduct the lift force from the gravity force and then multiply the result with the friction coefficient. In the case of rolling, the lift causes an extra moment, because it's upwards, so the lift gives you an extra moment to make the particle rotate. Yeah, so it helps to make the particle rotate. Here it also helps, because my resisting force, my friction force, is reduced. Here you see the resulting equation, so the Shields parameter is still the same, but we get the lift component in the denominator, and also here you get a lift component in the denominator. I put the whole story as a lecture note on Blackboard with all the derivations of all the equations, so there you can take a look at it.
If the particle is switched in position, wouldn't that lift force pushes the particles downwards?
Theoretically it could. But the thing is that the bottom part of the particle is not subject to flow. And if you look at if you look at the Bernoulli equation, that means, because the flow is over the particle, so P plus half rho V squared, so the pressure at the top is less. At the bottom you have the hydrostatic pressure, so the resulting pressure of pressure force is always upwards. But theoretically, you could have a downwards force. And there are measurements where they actually measured downwards forces, but not for a particle that is 50% above the bed. This is a graph of the lift coefficient. Maybe you remember the drag coefficient had a value of 0.446 for spheres. In the case of lift, you can see that this is the lift coefficient. Here you have the Reynolds number, and you can see for very small particles it goes to zero, and there are even measurements with a negative value for the lift coefficient, which means a downwards force. For high Reynolds numbers, you can see the average is about 0.2. But there are measurements up to, here you are at almost 0.8, but those measurements go to, let's say, 0.4. And you should consider that since the flow above the bed is not a stationary flow in the sense that everything is constantly the same. No, you have turbulence, so it's constantly changing. When will a particle start moving? If at one moment of time the forces are high enough to make it start moving. So if the lift force is not a constant, but it could change a little bit, depending on the flow and many things, then I shouldn't take the average for the lift coefficient, because I don't want to know when on average particles start moving. I want to know when the first particles start moving. So I chose a lift coefficient of about 0.4, to use in the model. What does it look like? Well, I should explain one more thing. We assume here that lift only occurs in turbulent flow. Theoretically, you can prove that in 100% laminar flow, there is no lift. You can prove that physically. So this lift contribution is only added for the turbulent part, so for this part. And what do you see? If we add this lift coefficient, this lift force, both curves match the measurements pretty well, although we have the yellow measurements, but I already told you they are sand, so that's why they are lower. They match it pretty well, and they get very close, but still sliding is easier than rolling. Yeah, so we should choose sliding as the mechanism. But in the viscous sublayer part, so the laminar part, nothing has changed. So how to correct for that? Well, we look at this again, and basically we use the same equations as before, but we add turbulence, because until now we assumed a certain velocity distribution, but the turbulent velocity distribution is an average, because you have those eddies, and because of the eddies, at a moment of time the velocity could be bigger, and at another moment of time it can be smaller. But the particle will start moving at that moment where the velocity is the biggest. Now, if you look at turbulence, is difficult to describe, but you can make a sort of distribution, a probability distribution, of the probability that the velocity is, for example, 2 times the average, or the probability that it's 3 times the average. Now you can make such a probability distribution based on turbulence. You don't have to completely understand this graph, but based on those probability distributions, in fact this is the distribution that I use, based on those distributions I can add turbulence to the laminar part of the curve, and what I did is this green line contains 3 times the average velocity based on that turbulent distribution. In fact, 3 times the variance of the probability distribution. It's in detail in the lecture notes. So now what you see is that the green line, the sliding line, matches the measurements pretty well. So, and then I didn't hear any question, how is that possible that if we are in the viscous sublayer with laminar flow, we add turbulence? Because in a laminar layer you don't have turbulence. Well, the reason is the same approach as Weiberg and Schmidt. We assume that this turbulence is contracting the viscous sublayer, resulting in higher velocities. That's what we assume. Because the viscous sublayer is the viscous sublayer, the amount of flow in cubic meters per second is a constant, so if it's thinner, you have higher velocities. And that's the approach to get this result. Then, mathematically, you can connect the two, and the result is this graph, where you can see that over the whole range, the green line for sliding is a little bit lower than the blue line, so sliding, in this case, would be the mechanism to make the particles move. Mm-hmm. If you have a constant flow through the viscous sublayer.
No.
So, in fact, what you assume is that you could put a piece of plastic on top of the viscous sublayer and you have a constant flow through that sublayer. That means if eddies, turbulent eddies, hit the sublayer, they push the plastic a little bit down, and then in the sublayer you would get a higher velocity because the flow is a constant. That's the assumption. And in fact, many people did measurements and they actually measured that this is what is happening. But if you want to know the details, you should follow a very sophisticated fluid mechanics course with Navier-Stokes and things like that. So this is the resulting curve. But like I told you, we assumed that particles are for 50% above the bed. So in that case, the mechanism will be sliding. Now we will do a short sensitivity analysis to see, okay, have we assumed a 30 degree friction angle? We assumed a number of other things, but how does the Shields curve depend on that? First of all, if we would change that friction angle, 25 degrees, 30 degrees, and 35 degrees, where would our curve go? Well, you can see that if I have a smaller friction angle, I get the red line, which is a little bit below the green line. The difference here is much bigger, in the laminar part, is much bigger than in the turbulent part. If I have a higher friction angle, 35 degrees, I'm a little bit above the curve. So that's it makes sense. If I have a higher friction angle, it's more difficult to make particles move. Yeah? In fact, it could even happen if I do that, if I would have a higher friction angle, it could happen that at that moment part of the line of the curve will be above the curve for rolling transport, which would mean I get rolling transport. If the resistance for sliding is too high, it will start rolling. Yeah. The next curve is the turbulence, the influence of turbulence. And here you can see the N value. The N value is the number of times that you apply the variance of your normal distribution of turbulence. So if I have an N of zero, it means I don't have any variance. Yeah, that means I have full laminar flow. Yeah, I'm at the average velocity distribution. I'm not considering any changes in velocity. That means N is zero. In that case, I would get this line. Yeah, so if I don't have any turbulence at all, this is my curve. Well, then you can see with n is 1, I get the red curve, n is 2, I get the blue curve, n is 3, I get the green curve, so that's the curve I'm using, and n is 4 would even give me a lower curve. Now, nature is unpredictable, which means on average, the n is 3 gives a good result. It doesn't mean in practice, in nature, you would never find a situation where you need one of the other N values. Yeah, but on average, N is 3 is a good value. Another exercise. If we change the lift coefficient, I told you I had a lift coefficient of 0.4, roughly. But what if I would use a lift coefficient of 0.2, which is the average? Well, green is a lift coefficient of 0.4, and the blue line is a lift coefficient of 0.2. If I have less lift, particles will not start moving that easy. Yeah? The more lift I have, the easier it is for the particles to start moving, because lift reduces the gravity, so reduces the friction on one hand, in the case of sliding, and in the case of rolling, the lift helps to create an overturning moment. Yeah? So in both cases, the more lift I have, the easier it is for particles to start moving. And then I also draw the red line, and the red line is the line for real sand when I use the CD value of sand. So the green line is the CD value of spheres, which was the 0.445. The red line is if I use the CD value for real sand, which could be 1.0, is much higher. And if you could think, yeah, but if I have a higher CD value, everything is more difficult. No, because the CD value results in the drag force on the particle. And the higher the drag force, the easier it is to start moving. Yeah, so a higher CD value here lowers the curve. But this mainly works in the turbulent region and not so much in the laminar region. This is some of the resulting curves of what we did. If you look at spheres based on different friction angles and based on different turbulence and based on different lift coefficients, you could say I have an upper curve, the blue curve. So that's with the smallest lift coefficient, with the highest friction coefficient, etc. Green is still the average one. Black is with a smaller friction coefficient, and this red line is for real sand. Yeah, so the top three lines are for spheres, and the bottom, the red line, is for real sand. So what you can see in those graphs is that although in literature they always just show one Shields curve, which is the green line, but if you do a sensitivity analysis and you say, okay, if I have more friction or more lift, you can see that you get a certain bandwidth. And of course, in nature, things will never be exactly at one point. You have a varying friction coefficient, you have a varying lift coefficient, etc., etc. If we look at those sensitivities in this graph, so the green line is the full Shields curve, you can see in this range I can move it up and down by changing the friction. Here I can kind of rotate the curve by changing the amount of turbulence. Yeah, so then here I can move it up and down by changing the friction, also by changing the drag, and also by changing the lift. Yeah, so I can adjust the whole curve according to those motions of the curve. And that means it's very important you choose the right parameters for your curve. But like I said, I use 30 degrees for the friction angle and 0.4 for the lift coefficient. And with those numbers, I get a curve that matches everything from literature, but also all the measurements. Yeah, so it's for me, it's a good curve. Some additional things. First of all, I already told you, we talk about 50% above the bed. You have exposure levels and protrusion levels. What is the difference? The exposure level is the percentage of the particle subject to the flow. The protrusion level is the percentage of the particle above the bed. Well, why do we need two words for that? That is because if you look into literature, you can see that they always assume the flow starts below the bed. Not at the bed level, but below the bed level. And how much? In some publications you find 0.2, so the flow starts at 0.2, 20% of the particle diameter below the top of the particle. In other literature you can find it's 25%. Well, the difference is not too much, and you have to choose one of the two, so I chose 20%. That means if my particle is at the same level of the whole bed, I have an exposure level of 0.2, 20%, and I have a protrusion level of 0. Yeah, because it's at the same level of the rest of the bed, but I have 20% subjected to flow. yeah, so that's the E. I use the letter E for the exposure level. So the only difference between the two is a factor 0.2. And if you add 0.2 to the protrusion level, you have the exposure level. So you can see we go from 0.2 to 1.2. Why 1.2 and not 1.0? Well, that's because if the flow starts at 0.2 below the top of the particle, then with an exposure level of 1.2, it means that particle is resting on top of the bed. Yeah, so the total flow is 1.2. To determine the forces on a particle, you have to say, okay, if this is my exposure level, then this part of the particle is subject to the flow. I have a certain velocity distribution, and based on that, I can calculate in much more detail the drag force and the lift force on that particle. All the equations, again, are in the lecture notes. So what I did is integrate those drag forces completely, so the whole shape of the particle is taken into account. And then you have to do that two times, because laminar flow and turbulent flow give different results. Yeah, so you get, in fact, two sets of numbers, and I put all the outcome as tables in the lecture notes. What does it look like? Well, if we look at sliding, because you have to distinguish sliding and rolling again. If you look at sliding, the red line in this graph is the case of 50% exposure level, yeah, 0.5. The green line is 1.0. That means the particle is 100% subject to the flow, but it's still not 100% above the bed. That's the lowest line. 1.2 exposure level. And that means the particle rests on top of the bed. Well, what you can see is that for sliding, the lines do not decrease too much if I have a higher exposure level. But you can see the higher the exposure level, the lower the curve, the easier it is to start moving, which makes sense. If a particle is completely on top of the rest, it's easy for that particle to start moving. Here you get the curves for rolling. Yeah?
All these graphs are on the x-axis. The Reynolds number, is that for the flow?
The Reynolds number, we call it the boundary Reynolds number, which is the particle diameter times the friction velocity divided by the viscosity. And in fact, they have a number of Reynolds numbers. You also have the so-called particle Reynolds number, where you determine the actual velocity on a particle times the diameter divided by the viscosity, which gives you a different result. So you have the boundary particle, the boundary Reynolds number is based on the friction velocity, and the particle Reynolds number is based on the real velocity. And you could define more Reynolds numbers, but those are the ones we often use. This is for rolling. What you can see is at the top, not much difference, but at the bottom you can see they are more downwards. What does it mean? Apparently, for particles that are have a very high exposure level, it's easier to start rolling than to start sliding, which makes sense. If I have a particle which is completely on top of other particles, in fact I do not need a moment to make it start rolling. It's like I have a marble on the table. Yeah, I don't need any force to make it start rolling. The rolling resistance is almost zero. So I found that for an exposure level somewhere between 0.6 and 0.7, rolling is easier than sliding. So for the high, for the low exposure levels, so that's, let's say, from 0.6 and higher, lower, we use sliding, and 0.6 and higher, we use rolling. Yeah, so, and if you would look in reality and you look at a bed and you start increasing the flow velocity above the sediment, you will actually see that it will start with some particles that start rolling, But if you further increase the velocity, at a certain point the velocity is so high that the whole top layer will start sliding. Yeah, so that's what you can see in this graph. The next graph is mixed. So what I did here, the top lines from 0.6 and lower are from the sliding calculations, and below, so that's the higher exposure levels, they are from rolling. And that means you can depending on your situation, you can use the whole graph depending on the exposure level. Here I use a different parameter on the horizontal axis. We call it the Bonneville parameter, which in fact is a dimensionless particle diameter. And the advantage of that is, if you convert the whole graph to that parameter, that the d star, the Bonneville parameter, is proportional to the real particle diameter, which I put at the top. So if you know your particle diameter, with this graph, immediately you can read what is the Shields parameter. Yeah, you don't have to deal with Reynolds numbers and so on. You can convert directly. So it's the same graph as the previous one, but now with another parameter on the horizontal axis. Yeah, and here you see the real particle diameter, but I must say this is valid for sand, for quartz and water. If you would have a different type of material and a different fluid, this doesn't work, because in the transition between the normal Shields graph and this graph, the viscosity is one of the parameters. So if I have a different fluid, then the factor between the two will be different. Yeah, so this is for normal sand, normal water, and then you have a graph that matches. Yeah, water, water. This is the last graph before the break. I also calculated everything for sand based on the CD value of sand, so with a higher drag coefficient. And then if you compare the two graphs, it's difficult to see now, but if you compare the two graphs, you will see that for sand, all the curves are a little bit lower than for spheres. Yeah, which makes sense, because you have more resistance, so it's easier for the particles to start moving. Okay, we will have a break. So we ended with the graphs for sand, and here you see the same graphs, but with many measurements, where each color is a different set of measurements, and we use those measurements to check if the theory was correct. Well, you can't see from a distance if all the points match the responding lines, but they do pretty well, and that's why we assume this is correct. Here you have what we call stages of entrainment. And what is stages of entrainment? If you look at erosion, you can say, okay, I have per square meter of surface, I have one particle starting to move. We have 10, we have 100, we have 1,000. And that way you can say, okay, I have different stages of entrainment, and the higher the stage, the more particles per square meter start moving. And here I put all the measurements from literature in this graph. And then you can see that those stages of entrainment match different exposure levels. So you can use the curves for different... if you take the lowest curve, yeah, particles with a very high exposure level will start moving. But there are not that many of those particles, so maybe it's just 10 per square meter. If I look at the highest curve, the whole surface starts moving. Yeah, so that's the highest level of entrainment. Well, those are all measurements. You can find in the lecture notes how much entrainment for each of the measurements. And you can see the higher the curve, the more particles per square meter starts moving. Then there are also in literature some measurements of what we call laminar main flow. Normally the main flow, so the flow above the bed, is turbulent, except for the viscous sublayer. But under certain circumstances, you can have a flow that is completely laminar. And if the flow is completely laminar, that also means you don't have turbulence, so you also don't have to deal with eddies and so on. And here you can see some measurements. The black line, again, is the line if you don't have any turbulence in your flow. And here you see a number of measurements in laminar flow. And you can see they do not completely match the black line, but more the second line, while those points here, the blue points, are in turbulent flow. So you can see that if you have laminar flow, completely laminar flow, you have to go more in the direction of this black line where you don't have any turbulence. Then the resulting Shields curves. We looked at many things, many sensitivities, and based on the whole study, you can say we can define four curves that you could use in practice. And those curves are 2x2. You have two for spheres and two for real sand. If you have spheres with turbulence, you get the green line, which is the Shields curve that you find in literature everywhere. Yeah, in all publications, they use that Shields curve. But if you would assume a laminar main flow, you get the blue line. And you can see that in this region, it's about the same. And the reason for that is that for very big particles, it's impossible to get laminar flow. It's always turbulent. So this part is turbulent in both cases, but this part gives a laminar main flow. Yeah? For laminar main flow, I need low velocities. Well, if I have low velocities, then big boulders will never start moving. Yeah. And then for real sands, I get this red line in the case of turbulent flow, and I get the black line in the case of laminar flow. Now, normally in reality, like if we look at that hopper at the end of the loading cycle of the hopper, it will always be turbulent flow. So that means we have to deal with the green line and with the red line. Yeah, that's turbulent flow. And then depending on whether the particles are completely spherical or very angular, you are somewhere in between the green and the red line. So if you find points below the green line for real sand, yeah, of course, because the drag coefficient was much higher. This graph I already showed, but in a different picture. This was the Shields-Parker diagram. The Shields curve. Then here we have a line. If you are above that line, you have suspension. If you are below the line, you don't have suspension. Here you see a line in the middle. If I'm on the left, I have ripples. If I'm on the right, I have dunes. And in this area here, I will have a flat bed. So here I will have dunes. Here I have a flat bed. In the previous graph that I showed you at the beginning of the presentation yesterday, those lines were under a certain angle. Now they are vertical. The reason for that is that in that other graph, they used another parameter on the horizontal axis, so you get a transition between two parameters, resulting in a line under an angle. If you use the Reynolds star, which is the boundary Reynolds number, if you see this star, it means you use the friction velocity in the Reynolds number.
And friction velocity is the resulting speed between the particles?
No, the friction velocity is a parameter with the dimension of velocity, but it is not a velocity. I will show you in one of the next slides. So this graph gives you the possibility to tell more about what kind of flow you can expect. So if you know a certain situation, you can calculate the Reynolds number and the Shields parameter, so you end up somewhere in this graph. And then you know, oh, do I have ripples, do I have dunes? In fact, last year or 2 years ago in the course, I told the students, if you make an app for the iPad, you get a 10. And there were two students who actually made an app. It's in the Apple Store. You can buy it for $5. So they cheated me. I had to pay $5 to give them a 10. But anyway, it's in the Apple Store. And in that app, you can actually enter the width and the height of a river. And it will calculate the point in the Shields curve. So you actually will see the Shields curve and where are you in the Shields curve. Governing equations. And this also answers your question. First of all, because this one slide is very important for the examination. In fact, if you have this slide, you have all the equations you need to answer the calculation questions. First of all, to calculate the friction velocity, we already saw this equation. So U star is the friction velocity, and because they in all literature they use U star, they use the star. So if you see a Reynolds star, it means they use the friction velocity to calculate the Reynolds number. So U star was the lambda, which is the friction coefficient of the flow, times the average velocity above the bed. So if I know the average velocity above the bed, I can calculate my U star. Lambda followed from this equation, where the D is the particle diameter, or if you would have ripples, the height of the ripples. So you can calculate your lambda. Theta, the Shields parameter, so the vertical axis of the Shields diagram, is U star squared, well, you already got it here, divided by the relative submerged density, which was about 1.65, g, and the particle diameter, and everything is in SI. So if you have a particle of 1 millimeter, it's 0.001, yeah, not 1, which some people do. If you do that, you get Reynolds number, which is too small, Shields parameter, which is too small. So I substituted this equation in the Shields parameter. So here you can see how to determine the Shields parameter. The Reynolds number that you normally have on the horizontal axis is the U star times the diameter divided by the viscosity. And normally in water, the viscosity is 10 to the power of minus 6. Yeah, so you should remember. And then, in fact, you have all the numbers you need for such a calculation. The bottom two equations you can use. So for example, if you want to know what would be the velocity exactly on the Shields curve, so what would be the velocity of the flow above a bed to be exactly on the Shields curve, then you have to read from the curve what is the Shields value, yeah, on the Shields curve, and all the other numbers are known. And then you can calculate the velocity required to be exactly on the Shields curve. And here I also reversed this equation. If I want to know with a certain velocity above the bed and a certain value of the Shields curve, what would be the particle diameter that will just start moving, I use this equation. Yeah, so in fact, all the equations basically are the same. I just reversed depending on what I want to know. So here, the knowns have to be the velocity and the particle diameter. Here, the knowns have to be the particle diameter and the Shields parameter. And here, the knowns have to be the velocity above the bed and the Shields parameter. Yeah, so in fact, you have three variables, the Shields parameter, the velocity, and the particle diameter. Yeah, so you can get three equations if you know two of them. This is the so-called Moody diagram. So this is the diagram you can use to determine the lambda value. At the bottom you have that same equation you already saw before. And normally we will, in pipeline transport, we use the lowest curve here. And for pipeline transport, also the Reynolds number on the horizontal axis is very big. So we are in this region normally, and that means our lambda value is roughly 0.01. So if I have hydraulic transport through pipelines, normally my lambda is roughly 0.01. But if I have a certain roughness, so in the case of a bed, then the particle diameter is at least your roughness. Yeah, I could be at one of the lines above it. So for example, if I'm at this line at high Reynolds numbers, yeah, it's like 0.025. So the lambda value could be twice as big. We use that if we have pipeline transport and you have a bed at the bottom of the pipeline, then you get two situations. You have a part of clean pipeline where you use the lambda value for steel, and on top of the bed you have to use the lambda value for the bed, yeah, with the particle size as the roughness. So in fact, in such a case, you use two different lambda values. The D was the hydraulic diameter. So basically, the hydraulic diameter is 4 times the cross-section divided by the circumference. That's the definition. If you look in Google for hydraulic diameter, you will get a Wikipedia page where they exactly explain what is the hydraulic diameter. But in those equations, you use the hydraulic diameter. If you have a civil engineering problem, so in mechanical engineering, where we talk about pipeline flow, we always use the hydraulic diameter, never the hydraulic radius. Yeah, it's always the hydraulic diameter. But in civil engineering, if you, for example, you have the flow through a river, you have to use, first of all, the concept of hydraulic diameter, because it's not circular, it's rectangular. And then if the width is much more than the thickness of the water layer, they defined that thickness as the hydraulic radius. But the thickness is not 1/2 of the diameter, it's 1/4 of the diameter. Doesn't make sense to me, but that's how they defined it long time ago. So in most hydraulic engineering books, you will see that they use the hydraulic radius, which again is 1/4 of the hydraulic diameter. In mechanical engineering, normally we always use the hydraulic diameter. Well, this one you already saw, and this is the result of some loading simulations of hopper dredges, where you can see here at the end, in fact, what I used in this graph is the green line is a very sophisticated software of Mr. Van Rey. He got his PhD on that, so he could simulate the whole loading process of hopper dredges by dividing it in small elements. So everywhere he knows exactly how much sand is there, what are the velocities, etc., etc. I have a more simple model. Probably he will explain it next week. And you can see the green line is the model of Van Rey, the blue line is my model. The difference is not much. So if a company wants to know how is the loading of a hopper and when should I stop, in both cases it's somewhere here, because there you get the erosion and you get curvature in your line. This line is what we call the overflow losses. So if, for example, at a certain moment of time there is 100% sand going into the hopper and 20% would not settle and leave through the overflow, then I will say I have 20% overflow losses. That's how overflow losses are defined. If I have very fine sand, it is very well possible on the whole loading cycle that I have 100% overflow losses. That means I have to dredge 2 times the content of the hopper, and then half will stay in the hopper and half will leave through the overflow. Yeah, that is possible. So this is one of the applications, and right now I'm busy with research into hydraulic transport. So if you have a bed in a pipeline, what is exactly happening? And I use the same theory for that. I think that's it for today, so we are finished early. Are there any questions? We can stop the recording, I think. Are there?